Do you know how a programmer communicates in a program with memory or RAM? Find out the answer in this video. My name is Tim Bichalka from the Learn Programming Academy, and in this video, you'll learn how a programmer communicates in a program with memory or RAM, as well as some other programming fundamentals. So we'll talk about some programming fundamentals that are typically found in every programming language, so knowing about them will help you to apply them in any programming language you may want to learn. Even if you're not planning on being a programmer, this familiarity will help you better understand what programmers need to do to have the computer serve up our very fascinating games and applications. Just as every spoken language, English, Spanish, French, German, etc., has its own language grammar syntax, so does every programming language. Starting with the basics of most programming languages, concepts of variables, constants, arrays, and objects are the building blocks for that language. Each of these four concepts are ways in which a programmer reserves memory, RAM to be used in the program to store data. Why is there typically four different ways to reserve memory? Well, to keep it simple, it really helps the programmer to better utilize the computer's memory resources, as well as help the humans who read and write the program to more quickly understand the purpose for reserving the memory. Variables are generally used to store data that can change during program execution. Constants are generally used to store data that cannot change during program execution. Arrays are used to store a list of similar type of data, for example, a list of student names who are taking a course. Objects are used to store characteristics and behaviors of a specific thing, where a thing can typically be a person, place, or thing. For example, an airport, such as Heathrow in England, has certain characteristics as well as certain behaviors, such as boarding people, aircraft taxiing, aircraft takeoff, aircraft landing, etc. Each variable, constant, etc. that the programmer uses is given a symbolic name in the program, and that name should conform to best practice for the specific programming language being used. A generic best practice for names is to use names that intuitively identify the kind of data that the variable, constant, etc. is storing in memory. For example, if I want a program to store two numbers and add them together to produce a result, then I could create three variables, naming them first number, second number, and result number. Keeping this explanation simple, these three named variables will reserve three different memory locations to hold the two numbers to be added, and a third memory location to store the result of adding the two numbers together. Two important aspects of what I've shared so far is that 1, notice the symbolic names can actually include multiple words, such as first number, second number, etc. But there can be no white space or blank space between the multiple words because the language compiler will think each word is a symbolic name for a memory location, hence we remove the white space between multiple words' symbolic names. Make sense? It's a bit strange, but programmers are very used to it. The second aspect to notice is that because the programmer uses symbolic names to reserve these three memory locations, the program is more generic, so that every time the program's executed, different actual number values, 6, 58, 2,978, etc., can be stored in those symbolically named memory addresses to produce a completely different result when added together. That's the beauty of symbolic names for memory addresses. One final thought, which might help further clarify this, is to equate a variable, constant, array, or object symbolic name as the address or location in memory, like a home or apartment address, and each address can store data in that memory location, much like people live in a specific home or apartment. A bit of a stretch, but sometimes it helps to try to visualize such concepts with real-world examples. I'm sure you know that 3 plus 2 equals 5, but did you know that Tim plus a space plus Bichalka equals Tim Bichalka? Find out how that's possible in the next video. Check it out and thanks for watching. Alrighty, this is the part of the video where I'm meant to get all enthusiastic and to ask you, or quite literally beg you, to subscribe to my channel and to like the video, leave a comment and all that stuff. Well, I'm going to leave that decision in your capable hands to decide whether I've earned a like or a subscribe or a comment. I'd be grateful if you do one, both, or all three. My videos will get out there and in front of a bigger audience if I get that level of engagement, but obviously it's your choice. Alright, so remember that this series was meant to be watched in order, so if you haven't watched from the start, then how dare you watch my video series out of order? Click the link over here to get to the first video in the series and watch that if you want to see the entire series in order. Or come over here and click to view the previous video in the series, again your choice. Alright, I'm done. Catch you in the next video.